All right, friends, so we are now up and running. Let's talk a little bit about these things called containers. So the first thing that I like to discuss or highlight when describing containers is why would we ever even need to use them? Now, in order to actually do this, we kind of have to understand a little bit about the history of how computers were managed. So let me just describe to you, okay? Let's imagine way back in the day, you needed to have, let's maybe say, 4 different operating systems, okay? What you would actually have to do is you would go out and you would go and buy 4 physical different machines, okay? So you would go out and buy these different machines, and because you now have 4 machines available to you, you now had the ability to install 4 different operating systems across all of these physical servers. Now, already you might be able to spot a problem. The first thing, and probably the most important thing, should you say, in this case here, is that this is rather costly and expensive. You're having to buy 4 different machines entirely just so you can run, say, for example, Red Hat Enterprise Linux on this, maybe Ubuntu on this. Let's maybe say you've got a Windows machine here. And let's maybe say you've got Kali Linux here, okay, whatever it may be. So obviously this is costly, and because of the physical nature of these machines, obviously this is going to take up space as well. So it's a problem on many different fronts. Now, in order to be able to defeat this problem, we had a very good solution, and it's a solution that I'm using right now. In fact, a solution I just recommended you use, and this was virtualization. What this would allow us to do, it would mean we could have 1 physical machine, so let's just take that one box, okay, the first one. And if we wanted to have multiple different operating systems, well, we could take this same machine and ultimately virtualize it and carve it up. So let's maybe say we just take the resources available on this machine, the physical resources such as the RAM and the hard disk space. And via the technology, we can ultimately cut this up and allocate it. So now what we can do is within the same machine, we can have all of these different operating systems. So already, this is a massive improvement over the original implementation. We only had to buy 1 physical server that's only going to take up the space of 1 server. But quite honestly, this is still not an optimal solution. It's not fully efficient, so to speak. So what could be the problem? Well, think about it. What are we actually able to virtualize here? We're virtualizing different operating systems. Now, these operating systems, well, they are not exactly the most lightweight thing in the world. For example, RHEL alone, if you wanted to virtualize it at a kind of minimum, you would need to allocate 2 GB of RAM and, like I say, maybe at least 20 GB of storage space. Now, in modern terms, these numbers are not exactly going to cripple your modern computer or modern server, but we cannot get away from the fact that this is still rather wasteful. If we don't need to use all this space and all of these resources, then why exactly are we just giving it away for free? So, let's suppose we didn't want to have multiple different operating systems. Rather, our consideration was we're going to have multiple different applications. In fact, there actually is a modern architecture within the world of application development, and this is something known as microservices, okay? Now, not to get too far ahead of ourselves, but microservices is ultimately the use of multiple different isolated applications all communicating with one another. Now, what we theoretically could do if we wanted to have multiple different applications talking to one another, well, we could essentially take a physical server and then within that physical server create a whole bunch of VMs. Okay, so let's maybe say 4 VMs. And inside of each VM, we could install 1 application, okay? So we do have this isolation between applications, but again, the problem is that we're going to have all of this additional overhead of installing all of these operating systems. Like I say, minimal for RHEL is going to be about 2 GB and 20 GB storage. Whereas the application itself, the thing that we're actually interested in, this might be rather lightweight. So think about it like this, as opposed to having to worry about standing up an entirely new operating system, what if we could just kind of virtualize only the application itself? As well as, by the way, all the things that this application needs to operate, so the files that it needs to use, all of the configurations, as well as any dependencies that it relies upon. So maybe it happens to use a particular programming language. Well, that could also be bundled up within the application. The point is, we're only going to be wrapping up and containerizing the things that we actually need, not the entire operating system. So instead, now what we can have is we can have our computer here. Say, for example, it's running Red Hat Enterprise Linux. And let's maybe say we had 4 different applications then as opposed to running them within virtual machines, we can just run the application directly within containers. And what's going to happen is that each container running on the system itself is going to be able to have access to the kernel of the host operating system, but that's essentially all it needs from the host. The rest of the dependencies, the configs, are all going to be within the container itself. So the net effect, the whole point of all of this, is we're going to have something that is way more portable, way more lightweight, and thus much more efficient. Now, one crucial point that really is very, very important, and we have touched upon it already in the context of our virtualization, but it's also true with our containers. Remember, in the setup portion of this particular skill, I happen to make a distinction between, say for example, MacBooks that happen to run the Apple Silicon, which is M1 or M2, versus, say for example, an older MacBook or a Windows machine. The difference here between these two is that they ultimately have a different architecture. And the difference in the architecture is, with respect to the MacBooks, they're going to be using ARM-based architecture, whereas if you happen to have an Intel-based processor, you will just use the regular 64-bit architecture. So what this means is that depending on the actual host operating system, because the actual containers themselves leverage the kernel of that host, we cannot have containers running in this cross-platform environment. What am I talking about? Well, let's imagine the host machine happens to be running an ARM-based architecture. So this can be Red Hat, Enterprise, Linux, whatever it may be. That means the containers within ultimately also have to leverage this type of architecture because they are essentially using that architecture. They're all using this particular kernel of the host. Whereas, let's imagine the host machine happened to be Intel-based architecture, then the containers within could not be ARM-based. They would also have to use the 64-bit architecture. Alright, so now we know the general purpose of containers. They are more lightweight and efficient as compared to traditional virtual machines. The containers themselves ultimately share the kernel of the host machine, thus we have to pay attention to the actual architecture of that host. Let's now turn our attention to how these containers actually operate.
Thanks for watching. If you're interested in a career in IT, or just looking to brush up your IT skills, then be sure to visit cbtnuggets.com for a free trial.